Good morning. This is Faith in Our Hometown, brought to you as a community service and sponsored by Mercy Hospital Joplin. And now, here is your host, Father Jay Friedel.
Good morning and welcome or welcome back to Faith in Our Hometown. If you caught our show last week, we were talking a little bit about how do we respond to violence as people who live in a violent society, both as people of faith and as just people who care. This morning, we're going to take a little bit more of a philosophical approach to some of those same issues, but with a little bit of a different twist. To do that, we have one of our more philosophical churches here in the Joplin area, Unity of Joplin. And Gordon Kyler's here to join us, who's the spiritual leader over at Unity. So thanks for joining us again this morning, Gordon.
Glad to be here.
This morning, we're going to talk about the source and the nature of evil. Where does evil come from? Well, what is it all about? Does it come from outside? Does it come from within? Well, how do we deal with it? How do we make ourselves, how can we choose it, or how can we stay away from it? Those are going to be some of the things that we talk about this morning here on Faith in Our Hometown. We're going to be right back after this Mercy Minute. Don't go away. We'll be right back with you.
I thought about bariatric surgery because of the struggles I've had with my weight all my life. Every time I tried a new fad diet or a new diet, it seemed like I always put back more weight on than I lost. And then, of course, that leads to a very downward cycle of being very hard on yourself, being very depressed. It's been amazing. I mean, it's been shocking. I feel like a whole new person, you know, inside and out. You know, it's just not with the surgery, but also with, again, with the care team and everything involved. The dietitian, the therapy, and everything has been, I feel reborn. I'm able to do things that I want to do. I'm not held back by my weight. I'm not held back by my depression. I'm not held back by the emotional weight and physical weight I was carrying around. I feel free. I feel like I can do anything.
Well, thanks for staying with us. Again, my guest this morning is Gordon Kyler of Unity of Joplin, and we're talking a little bit about the philosophical nature of evil. Where does evil come from, Gordon? You know, how do you all approach that in terms of your life as a church over at Unity of Joplin?
We believe very much in our personal role in spirituality. Thus, we believe that evil does come from within us. It's an effect of being, for lack of a better phrase, unplugged from spirit, to being out of alignment with God's intention, which is to come from a place of love and understanding.
Okay.
We are dualistic beings. We have ego, which is a reactionary energy, and we have heart, which is a responsive energy. When we get focused on ego, forgetting our connection to the divine, we come from a place of reaction. And that can be being in opposition to spirit. I use the example of, if you look at the word evil, E-V-I-L, look at it backwards, L-I-V-E. Evil is what happens when we are living backwards, when we are living in opposition as it is to spirit, to a place of love. When I speak to youth about this, I compare it to walking backwards down the street. If we were to go out to Main Street on Saturday morning and walk backwards down the street, we are going to bump into people, we're going to knock them over, we're going to knock things over, we're going to create mayhem. We're going to create and experience evil in our own personal experience, and we're going to project that onto those we bump into. Being human beings, they have the choice to react from a place of ego. You hurt me, I'm going to hurt you back. Or say,
common response. Yeah.
Or respond from a place of spirit, saying, whoa, wait a minute, turn around. When we turn around, we see where we're going, we're back in alignment with the flow of love.
And, you know, and to put that in, you know, I guess, you know, more traditional Christian terms, mm-hmm. you know, we could talk about the fact that when, you know, we're in alignment with God's will, we're living in grace. Yeah. We're receiving God's grace and we're living it accordingly. Whenever we choose to reject God's grace or live not in accordance with that grace, then we sin.
Right.
And so the sin then causes more chaos disunion with God, disunion with others, disunion within ourselves. And because of that, you know, we're out of alignment. Yes. We're living a life of sin rather than a life of grace. And I think there's a pretty good, you know, there's a pretty good connection. I like your little metaphorical, you know, evil live, you know, backwards. Etymologically, of course, you know, evil is, you know, more just, you know, it was a word that was used for anything that was disruptive or out of order or those things. So it's the same thing etymologically within that thing. And of course, and I'm going to toss this out here because they're going to have to deal with it, you know, because of the way a lot of people think about this. And that is the word devil comes from the same thing. Mm-hmm. Devil and evil come from the same roots. The devil would just be of that disruption, of that bad, of that chaos, of that, you know, of that evil. And so, you know, some people, I think, would you know, would get to that phrase of, you know, the devil made me do it, you know. And again, not necessarily the way you would describe it, not necessarily out of sync with it though either.
Right.
Okay. So, but I'll give you a chance to respond to that because I think I know how you're going to respond to it. But for everybody else, so is there a devil in the way you guys think about this? Is a unity church?
There is not a devil in our philosophy. You know, the little red guy with the horns that was cast out of heaven. We do not believe in that. We do believe that what we give energy to, we manifest, bring it forth into our world. So if we are focused on an eye for an eye of creating mayhem, creating evil, we are going to create a devilish experience. We are going to create that energy of a devil. But the beauty of it is, you mentioned sin, which is a result of evil, of practicing evil. The beauty is, it's not permanent. Jesus said, if you want to overcome sin, repent, which means literally to turn around.
Yep.
Just as the metaphor of walking down the street backward. Turn around, it's gone, it's done. Now, sometimes there are consequences. Sometimes there are healings that have to occur because of our actions.
Sure.
That is where forgiveness comes in. That is where our spiritual practice comes in. And that is also where we begin to express into our world a different energy of peace and understanding. Is there a devil per se? No, we do not believe there is.
Okay. Well, now that would be a little bit at odds with the way, you know, most traditional Christians would examine that. Because, and again, I would say our Jewish and Muslim brothers and sisters, and any of those who really believe that there's anybody whose cosmology or their worldview includes things that are seen and unseen. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, in other words, many different, you know, world traditions would also say, well, the reality that we see here on Earth is only part of what exists. There are other things that exist. So, you know, here in our physical world, you know, it's not just the physical that just you and I and other things that we can see and touch, but there are also things of spirit.
Yeah.
So within this context, the way traditional Christianity and some of those other world traditions would also look at this would be to say, well, just the same way that there are good spirits, there are also evil spirits. Same way that there are good people, there are bad people. So that from time to time, for example, you know, if you're praying and asking your friends on the other side for intercession, or you're praying and asking your grandma to watch over you, and she's sending you good vibes from the other side, so maybe not a good spirit could then send some bad vibes and plague us as well. One of the things, and this is one of the things that a lot of times, I know Catholics mess up, so if we mess it up, I know a lot of Christians mess this up, but again, philosophically, there's no, God doesn't have an opposite within our worldview.
That's true.
God does not have an opposite. So the devil is not the opposite of God. The devil would actually be the opposite of a good spirit.
There you go.
Okay?
Yeah.
The devil would be the opposite of a good spirit, not the opposite of God, at least in the traditional Judeo-Christian way of looking at things.
Right.
God is God, and God doesn't have an opposite.
Yes.
Okay? And so there's not a dualism in terms of that. God is, but within all of those things that he did, again, with free will, humans got free will, so did the spirits. Some want to choose to function in conjunction with his will. Some want to choose not to function in conjunction with his will. Hence, good people, bad people, hence good spirits, bad spirits.
And you
so that would
spirits.
Be a traditional way,
You use the word spirits, and we're very close in this.
Sure.
We would use the word energy.
Mm-hmm.
You and I are sitting here, and we have our different viewpoints, but we love and respect each other.
Sure.
We could also be doing a show where we're at each other and arguing with each other and telling each other how wrong.
I've got you by a few pounds. You might go down, but
true.
I'm just saying.
I don't know. I got a fair few amount of pounds here myself. But we could do a show like that. What energy are we projecting out into the world at that point?
Sure.
Are we projecting a spiritual, saintly energy? Are we projecting an energy or a spirit of devil, of evil? What are we creating? What we create is going to feed the people who are watching us right now.
Sure.
There are very charismatic people in the world who project different energies or spirit into the world. We see them leading violent movements. We see them through some of the incidences we've seen in Orlando and places like that in the past weeks. Sometimes they are so charismatic and so powerful, they attract followers. They bring people who are in the same place consciously that they are.
Right.
That is where we begin to see evil exponentially increase. What do we do about that? We hold a place of peace. We project an energy of peace. We pray, which I do believe can have an effect on a bigger scale than our immediate circle.
And again, that would put you in common
yes.
company with any of the traditions who pray.
That is true.
Yep. You know, prayer is not so much, or at least as I tell my younger students especially, prayer is not so much to change God as it
it's
is to change us.
Yes.
You know, if you really think that your prayers are going to somehow change God, you haven't been doing it very long.
No.
Because you'll be completely frustrated by it, you know.
That is the truth.
At any point in time. Yeah. I get a great story, you know, about that. It's a good little Catholic story. Are you in the mood for one this
yes,
morning?
Yes, I am. I'll probably steal it and use it on Sunday.
Go for it. You might have to unity it up a little bit,
sure.
But it's okay. All right. But at any rate, you know, so this little kid said, you know, if you pray hard enough, God will give you what you want. You know, God will give you what you want. And so he was praying for a new bike. And, you know, didn't get the bike. And so, you know, I said, well, you know, Mom and Dad are going, well, you just got to pray harder, honey. God always answers your prayers. You know, you just pray. I'm praying for a new bike. Okay, so at any rate, you know, at that point in time, you know, he still wasn't getting the bike. So he decides he's going to try a different strategy. And I remember this kid's Catholic. So we've got family pictures everywhere, statues, pictures, all that stuff. So he takes the statue of Mary, Jesus' mother,
right.
Who's on his nightstand, and he takes it and he wraps it up in a pillowcase and he buries it in his bottom drawer. And the next night he goes to pray and says, "Dear Jesus, if you ever want to see your mother again, you're going to get me that bike." So we're not about manipulating
yes,
God with our prayers.
That
That's not the way it works.
Yeah.
You know, it's not the way it works. We pray to change us, not to change God. And I agree with you that I think that by putting out those positive, you know, vibes or positive prayers or just praying for the world or doing those things, we do have the power to influence things beyond ourselves. You know, and I think that in that regard, you know, our values and our practices line up. We may use different words.
Yes.
We may use different images, different ways of bringing that about. But when we come back, I want to talk some more about those other spiritual practices. Aaron Brown was here last week. We were talking about spiritual practices, and we didn't get a chance to talk about it a whole lot. So let's talk about some of those things that we might do in order to push out that more positive, you know, force in the world. Because I think we need to do that as people of faith, to push out a little bit more positive, because God knows there's plenty of negative that keeps coming our way. So we're going to be back in just a few seconds here. This is Faith in Our Hometown. Thanks for being with us this morning.
You're watching Faith in Our Hometown on KSN TV, brought to you as a community service and sponsored by Mercy Hospital Joplin.
Well, thanks for staying with us this morning. We are here with Faith in Our Hometown. Again, my guest this morning is Gordon Kyler, who's at the Unity Church of Joplin. Right before the break, we were talking a little bit about how we can push out some of that positive energy in the world, in a world that sometimes is very negative. How do we push out, you know, grace-filled thoughts as opposed to what I would call evil, or even if you want to use the word demonic thoughts, okay? How do we do some of those things? How do we be those good spirits that create that good stuff in the world? What are some of the practices that you guys do at Unity?
Well, of course, you know from some of our earlier shows that Unity was founded on prayer, Silent Unity in particular. First and foremost, always we go in prayer first. you know, seeking the discernment of God. You were telling the story about the child who was praying for the new bike. And sometimes we don't even know what to pray for. You know, let's take Orlando a couple weeks ago as an incident. What do we pray for? Do we pray for forgiveness? Do we pray for comfort for the families? Do we pray for an awakening in society as a whole? Or do we just say, God, I don't know what to pray for, but I know you do. I'm reminded of a story I heard once about an angel. God sent the angels out to find the perfect prayer. They went to temples, they went to churches, they went to synagogues, they went to ashrams, found all these beautiful, glorious prayers. And one angel went into a home and heard a little child praying A, B, C, D, E, F, G. And the angel said, I gotta find out what's going on here. Went down to the child, he said, what are you doing? He says, I'm too young to know what to pray for. So I'm giving God the letters, he'll know what to do with them.
Mm.
So what we do is
like
we
that.
Say, okay, God.
You can steal my story, I'll steal
okay.
yours. It's
you
pretty
got a
good,
deal.
I like it.
So we say, okay, what is needed here? Is it healing? Is it forgiveness? Is it an awakening for the community, for society as a whole, for myself? What is my part in this?
Yeah.
And through that, we seek discernment. And out of that, we are led to how can we respond? How can we respond to this appearance of evil in our world?
Yeah. Well, the passage, you know, comes to me, you know, about, you know, that the Spirit makes up for our groanings because we don't know
yes.
for which to pray.
Yeah.
You know, and I really do believe that is part of the reality of life. I mean, we actually got a group over at St. Peter's that just does nothing but seated meditation.
Yeah.
They don't use any words.
We
I mean, they may use
too.
The scriptures. They may try to set everything up. They do their thing. But the bottom line is that the group has just kind of said, you know, I'm getting to that point. And several of the folks are a little older. You know, and they've been praying for years and years and years, and now they're getting to that point where they're saying, I just want to sit with God.
Yes.
I just want to sit with God and not worry about the words. I just want to be with Him. And again, it's the discipline of coming together that group does.
Mm-hmm.
That the reason why they sit and do it is because they know that they're committed to being there for this period of time on an afternoon and making it work. Or the other thing, practice we have as Catholics is, we do what we call Eucharistic adoration,
mm-hmm.
all right, which is a fancy word for saying spending a little quiet time with Jesus.
Yeah.
So, when, you know, and that's why in Catholic churches, you know, we've got a tabernacle week, because again, it's like taking what we practice on Sunday and freezing it in freeze frame for everybody,
right.
You know, to say, okay, what is this I'm supposed to be? How is this I'm supposed to become? Who is this I'm supposed to be like? And it's about getting our lives more aligned with Jesus. So, I always laugh because my students would say, you know, just like, oh gosh, I started doing Eucharistic adoration, it's changed my life. And I laugh at them because I just said, if you'd have just stopped anywhere and started paying attention for an hour at a time, you'd find your life changing. Because they're committed to come for that hour, they suddenly come and they don't do anything else. There's nothing else on the agenda but listening to whatever it is God's trying to say to them. And they wonder why their lives start changing.
Yeah.
And I'm like, it's not rocket science.
It's not.
It's just
Buddhists
call it
mindfulness.
It's a practice of faith. Exactly.
Yeah. In Unity, we do the same thing. We do what we call insight meditation, which is one form of meditation where you sit in the silence.
Yeah.
And it's interesting. People come out of the silence and they say, I didn't get any message. 2 or 3 days later, it shows up. What we do is we create the space for the message to come in, for the guidance to come in.
I think that's just an important aspect of prayer that sometimes we don't get to because we're so busy using, we're so busy putting all the words on it. And I mean, you know, it's just like, when I was over in Piedmont, Missouri, it's the first place I was a pastor, so 26, 27 years ago, whatever it was, I always had this practice of, and we're told that we should leave some room for silence in our prayer, but we don't, we're very uncomfortable with it. So every time I go somewhere and I start using a minute here, and then I got to use a couple minutes, and this one little kid at one point in time who was so not used to it, I was being quiet after communion and just sitting there quietly and just letting everybody breathe together and just pray after communion and our prayer, we're getting toward the end of everything, and all of a sudden I hear this 3-year-old voice from the back go, what's he doing up there, Mom? I think he's sleeping. And the whole place just erupted because we were all being quiet as it happened. So I just started laughing. I said, no, Kevin, I actually am not sleeping. I was praying. Can you pray real quietly for just a few more minutes? And he went, yeah. And so we went back to it and did our thing. But yes. Silence is one of those things that is, it's a very highly underrated spiritual practice.
Yeah.
And we don't talk about it very often.
There's an author named Joel Goldsmith who wrote a book one time called The Thunder of Silence. And it is powerful. We had an incident at one of our conferences just recently. In Unity, we have ministers who are of the LGBT community. Mm-hmm. Some of them are couples. We had an incident right in Kansas City a few weeks ago where they were thrown out of a restaurant because they were an LGBT, a same-sex couple. And what we did is we went into prayer. Now, we could have gotten angry and the whole conference body could have descended upon downtown Kansas City and protested. We went into prayer. We silently went into the restaurant. We also contacted the owners of the restaurant and asked them, is this really your policy? You know what happened? They apologized profusely. It was not their policy. It was an individual's reaction.
Sure.
We went in with peace. We went in with understanding, and we confronted the evil with love, and a transformation occurred.
You know, and again, regardless of religious boundaries, I think that all of us can stand to try to that, because that's a great spiritual practice, is how do we, mm-hmm. how do we address evil? How do we address whatever is wrong? How do we address the dissonance? But instead of creating more dissonance, how do we open it up for God to be present, for there to be the possibility of more healing to do some of those things?
And one of the ways we can do that is look for the good.
Mm-hmm.
Look for the good in a situation. When you had the show with Aaron Brown a week ago, I heard you mention something about God was present in Orlando.
Mm-hmm.
Where do we see God in the Middle East? Where do we see God in Africa, where there's violence? Where do we see God in evil situations or what appears to be evil, in the midst of tragedy, in the midst of pain and suffering? Do we look and do we focus on that? Do we focus on the evil, or do we focus on the potential of good? Do we focus on the presence of God in those situations? One of the things we don't experience here in our culture is a media that shows us both sides of a situation. There are communities in the Middle East where people of different religions live side by side peacefully, where they work together, where they go to school together. You will never see that on our TV.
Well,
not often.
But let's talk about that for a second. I mean, I think that we've got a pretty good model here in Joplin.
Yes, we do.
You know?
We do.
And I want to give the community some kudos for that. Now,
yes.
I don't think we, again, and that's part of the reason why we wanted to do this show in the first place. But we don't always understand each other.
Right.
Okay? And we don't even always agree with each other. But that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
But how do we still live peacefully side by side? Living with each other, cooperating with each other to the level that we feel comfortable or can. How do we still pray for each other? And I don't necessarily mean pray for your conversion so that you'll see it my way. But I mean just praying that God will take care of you in the way that God wants to take care of you rather than in the way that Jay wants to take care of you.
Right.
You know, how do we do some of those things? And I think we do that fairly well here in Joplin.
We're doing it right now.
Exactly. Yeah. And I hope that that's a model for, you know, people. Because again, I don't... if I thought that this show was about everybody agreeing with each other, well, that would be we'd already be shut down too, because that's not going to happen.
Right.
But the whole point here is that how can we get closer to each other and rub up against each other in a good and positive way, so that we can learn from each other, perhaps, you know, be challenged to look at or see something in a different way.
Yeah.
You know, and again, even if we're not in complete lockstep with each other, how are we creating a more positive aspect of things in the community? Or to use the language we were using this morning about the source of the nature of evil, okay, or the source of the nature of good, how can we be agents for that good rather than tearing it all apart, which is, if you ask me, would be being an agent for evil.
Yes.
I mean, I see a lot of people.
Right.
Yeah. I see a lot of people who are very good intentioned and very good natured, but they wind up destroying things because they don't know how to engage them.
Yeah.
You know? And the real thing is they're trying to do good, but I think they're actually sometimes accomplishing the opposite because they don't know how to go about it.
Right.
And I think we just got to continue to try to model that for our people in terms of those things. Real quick, just anything else that we've missed that that maybe you wanted to talk about in terms of the source and the nature of evil or any other practices that we need to pay attention to?
Well, I think
as we're getting ready
next
to close.
To prayer, the next most important practice is what we model on this show is listening to each other. I have learned so much from you and the other guests that have been on the show I didn't know. And I'm finding out we have a whole lot more in common than we do different.
Oh,
our
sure.
terminology may be different. We may have a different flavor. But we really are all focused on the same thing, and that is raising the spiritual consciousness, not religious, but spiritual consciousness.
Well, I got to raise a little religious consciousness,
yeah, okay.
too. You know? It's just the way I am. It's the way it works.
But ultimately, it's all about love. It's all about love and acceptance and seeing the divine in each other.
Well, as St. Paul would have said, you know, I can be flashy and fancy about a lot of things, but if I don't have love, it's not going to amount to anything.
Yeah.
And I think that that's why love is the greatest virtue of all.
Yeah.
How do we learn how to do that? And how do we learn how to do it in the practical? It's always a challenge, you know, especially when you're dealing with somebody who's different. How do I love that person who's LGBT if I don't know one? How do I love that person from Unity if I don't know what they, who they are, what they do?
Yes.
So how do we make it a little bit more positive? Well, we're going to be right back after this Mercy Minute. Thanks for joining us this morning. Stay with us.
If there's a family history of breast cancer, especially breast cancer at an early age, that's a very high risk factor for breast cancer, and those patients you know, should have early surveillance and should be aware of some of the signs and symptoms of early breast cancer. Other risk factors would include maintaining an optimal weight. If one carries excess weight, that increases baseline estrogen levels, and that seems to increase the risk of breast cancer. Those would be the main risk factors.
Well, hi, I'm Jay Friedel, the Catholic priest over at St. Peter's at 8th and Pearl, and our host always every week for Faith in Our Hometown. Thank you for joining us this morning for a great conversation with Gordon Kyler from the Unity of Joplin, just talking about what is the source and the nature of evil. Here in our community, you know, we need to try to continue to practice good things, because that's the way that we bring more good into the community. And I think we could probably all agree on that, whether or not we're believers or not believers, or regardless of what belief or practice system that we have. But I think we need to continue to try to search for those practices that are going to increase the amount of good and the amount of positive things that we can do as a community here in Joplin and as a community here in the world. It is a challenge for us, because sometimes we want to cling to what we know, but sometimes we gotta stretch ourselves so that we can reach out to others in peace, goodwill, and in love. That needs to be the practice for faith in our hometown.
Thanks for watching. Faith in Our Hometown can be seen Sunday mornings at 6:30 and 9 a.m. on KSN. Brought to you as a community service and sponsored by Mercy Hospital, Joplin.